to talk about how to build personas that you'll actually use. And one of the things that happens is that potential clients call me and they say, look, we only have a limited budget. Can we just develop a content strategy? Can we just develop a lead nurture program? We'll get to the buyer personas, but let's do that first because we really need to get content out the door. And my response to them is, that's all fine and dandy, but who the heck are we going to talk to? And why will they care? And what are we going to say that's relevant to them? And so one of my big things in life is making sure that we have the foundation that drives our strategies. And in my world, that begins with personas. And it's really important to do that research first so you know who your audience is and who you're talking to. The other situation that comes up quite often is clients will say to me, yeah, we have personas. We'll send them over to you so we can just get started right on the content strategy. And I'll say to them, well, that's great. How have you used them? And if I was in the same room with them, I'd get a deer in the headlights look, like, oh. And most of them just simply don't understand how they should use them. But in all fairness to marketers, quite often what I find when they send the personas over is that the personas don't give them anything to use. And so what I really want you to get out of today's session is how to build the persona that gives you the information you need to drive a content marketing strategy, and how to find that information and what it looks like in play. So the other reason that I think this is really, really important is that we are, as marketers, continuously producing more and more content year over year, but research finds that we're getting less engagement. So TrackMaven, who's one of our sponsors for at least the last 2 years, I believe, has produced a report called The Content Paradox. And what they found in the most recent report is that we're producing 35% more content, but we're getting 17% less engagement. Think about that for a minute. We're not on the right track. You know, that's a waste of resources, and God knows we don't have a lot of those to waste. So we're going to talk about why personas bring clarity and the relevance you need to increase your marketing performance and actually be seen as producing assets for the company and not a cost center. So just as a level set, I want everybody in the room to understand what I mean when I'm talking about a persona. So for me, a persona is a composite sketch of a target market based on validated commonalities, okay, not assumptions, validated commonalities that actively informs a content strategy to drive productive buyer engagement, in other words, revenue. Okay? So let's talk about commonalities for a minute. A lot of us get really excited when we find this unique attribute about one of our customers. We think, oh, this is cool. Let's focus on that. You know what the problem is? If you focus on what the person wearing the red shoes is interested in, you're missing all the people in the white shoes. So what we really need to do as marketers, unless you guys are advanced enough to have the capability to do one-to-one, which I haven't seen very often, except maybe in account-based programs that are smaller, is we need to focus on the commonalities, because focusing on that will allow us to be relevant to a wider swath of that target market. So that's what we're really looking for. Now, in my world, there are 9 components in a persona. And we're going to talk about each of the components, and I'm going to give you examples of what they should not include and what they should include. So we're going to go through that to give you an idea so that you can start seeing the value of the information that can be contained in your personas when you take the time to build them correctly. I'm waiting for the picture people. Okay, there you go. All right. So this is the first component in a persona, but it's also the one I develop last after I have gathered all the information for the others. The point of a day in the life is that it should be the component that allows you to step into the buyer's shoes, into this persona's shoes. It's very useful when you're giving an assignment to a content writer. When they read this, they should be able to say, okay, I really get this person. The reason it's written in first person is so that it's like them talking to you, not you talking about them. So for example, under the no, there's the statement, Diane is a hard worker who is determined to make product launches more efficient. Well, that's great. Tells you a little bit about her. But let's look at the statement under the yes. I'm struggling to get products to market faster because our processes are too convoluted. But my boss is worried that changing them will create even more chaos. Does that give you a better feeling about who Diane is and what she's struggling with? But here's the key thing I want you to get. My boss. That's likely another persona in your set of buying committee personas. You want to incorporate each persona's relationship with the other personas on the buying committee. Now, quite often we look at personas in silos. So we could have a track for Diane. We could have a track for her boss. We could have a track for a third persona, whatever. What we fail to look at with personas is, what's that overlay? What are their relationships with each other? Who's going to push back on who? How can we counter that stuff with the kind of content we create? So imagine knowing this versus the statement on the top, where you could create content that talks about how to convince your boss that making a change is actually better than living with the disruption you already have. You know, different things like that. Now, a first-person scenario doesn't need to be a novel, okay? About 300 words should do it. And the reason you write it last is because you kind of want to incorporate stuff from the other components so you get a really good overall feel for your persona.